be seated.
Good morning. How are y'all today? Good. I'd like to welcome you to Family Church, as we are passionate about loving God passionately and loving people personally. Just a reminder about our new COVID protocols. We highly recommend that you wear them when interacting with people and walking around, but if you're seated, you don't have to wear them. And so it's nice seeing a lot of y'all's lovely faces again. It's very lovely. So let's go before the Lord in prayer before we continue worshiping together. Father God, thank you so much for today. Thank you so much for the ability to worship you in this place safely. We thank you for covering our sins by the blood of the cross, for allowing us to enter into a relationship with you. We thank you for giving us a space to breathe, a space of rest. We thank you for being faithful, regardless of the circumstances. We praise you. Amen. Y'all can stand and worship with us.
No.
God, we thank you so much for your many blessings in our lives.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to be. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given. Morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes. My chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death. so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so
Father, we thank you for all the blessings you've placed in our lives, the sacrifice of sending your son to die for us. And I pray that we would remember all the things that you've done for us. And that when we sit, when we have dark days, when we have good days, when we think that we're doing awesome, when we think that we cannot win, that we would remember that you are a good God, and that you do love us. So one more time from the very depths of our hearts, where we hide your word and where we often try to bury our worldly problems.
so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Amen, church. You may be seated.
We are like clay, static, unrecognizable, nothing. A formless mass with no direction, no purpose, no meaning. We are like clay, pliable, movable, moldable. In the hands of the Creator, we can be changed. Made beautiful, given life, nothing becomes something extraordinary. The transformation takes time. The process is tedious, difficult, painstaking. But soon, we see the beginnings of something wonderful. The formless takes shape. The unrecognizable finds its identity. The meaningless is given purpose. From nothing comes beauty. We are like clay, each piece different than the next, given unlimited potential in the hands of the potter.
Then according to the word sent by Darius the king, Tattenai, the governor of the province beyond the river, Shethar-Bozenai and their associates did with all diligence what Darius the king had ordered. And the elders of the Jews built and prospered through the prophesying of Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the son of Iddo. They finished their building by decree of the God of Israel and by the decree of Cyrus and Darius and Xerxes, king of Persia. And this house was finished on the third day of the month of Adar, in the sixth year of the reign of Darius the king. And the people of Israel, the priests and the Levites, and the rest of the returned exiles celebrated the dedication of this house of God with joy. Verse 19, on the 14th day of the first month, the returned exiles kept the Passover, for the priests and the Levites had purified themselves together. All of them were clean. So they slaughtered the Passover lamb for all the returned exiles, for their fellow priests, and for themselves. It was eaten by the people of Israel who had returned from exile, and also by everyone who had joined them and separated himself from the uncleanness of the peoples of the land to worship the Lord, the God of Israel. And they kept the feast of unleavened bread 7 days with joy, for the Lord had made them joyful and had turned the heart of the king of Assyria to them, so that he aided them in the work of the house of God, the God of Israel. Father God, I thank you for your word, Father. I thank you for bringing us here this morning, Father, as we celebrate the women in our lives, Father. Lord, I just pray blessings over our mothers and over our women, Father God. Lord, I pray for Pastor Dean as he brings your word this morning, that you would use them, that you would speak through him, Father. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
All of that, we are thankful for the women in our lives. And we see that God's hand of providence and work is done through, especially the women that follow him. And so we see the same thing today, that God's hand is at work in his people. And so
maybe the ladies in here, maybe there's sometimes you feel discouraged. Know that God is working through you and God influences others through you. And so we celebrate his work through you today. We want to make sure before you leave later, we do have a flower that we would like to give you, a rose here on Mother's Day. So make sure as you're heading out that you don't leave without getting one. I believe Colden or somebody's going to be handing those out later. And so we're excited to celebrate you. Today, we're continuing our time in Ezra. We have two more weeks left in Ezra after this. And then we'll be moving on to Nehemiah and finishing up Nehemiah probably right before or after the 4th of July. And so today's sermon is entitled The Remembrance. And really, this text today brings to conclusion the first half of the book of Ezra. Now, Ezra and Nehemiah were once the same book. In many of the Jewish Bibles, they are the same book. It was split just to make it easier to follow and read. And even like Luke and Acts were likely the same volumes of the same work. And so there's several books in the Bible that have been split, like the book of Kings, which is 1 Kings and 2 Kings. And so we see that Ezra and Nehemiah tells the story of Israel coming out of captivity back into the promised land. And this wraps the first half of Ezra, which focuses on Zerubbabel and Yeshua and their rebuilding of the temple. And now next week, we're going to have 2 weeks with Ezra. And then Ezra ends up being in the story of Nehemiah as well. And Ezra is a priest who calls Israel out the temple and the altar and the Let's see, can you, y'all can hear me now, so, and hey, internet world. So here we go. So this story wraps up Zerubbabel and Yeshua's story of rebuilding the temple, and what we see is the big idea is this: the temple's been rebuilt, and we see that God's people remember his sovereignty and his goodness in rebuilding the temple and returning them to the land. So our big idea is this: God's people celebrate his work. God's people celebrate his work. Just today, as we celebrate mothers, and in a few weeks, we celebrate fathers and men in our lives. We celebrate his work. So when we celebrate others, we are ultimately celebrating the God who is behind his work. And that's our first point today, which is God completes his work. Don't rest in knowing that this work that took place in rebuilding the temple and returning Israel to the promised land and the altar being rebuilt and all that is the work of Yahweh. We're just saying, breathing you in, Yahweh. God the Father is in charge of this work, and it comes to completion by his hands. And what we see last week, we saw there was some opposition to this work. And the part of Ezra that we skipped over actually looks into the future and sees that Israel is continuously having obstacles to getting their work done. And what we see is even the work on the temple had ceased for some time because of this opposition. In fact, Cyrus, who was the original person who decreed that Israel could come back to the promised land, Cyrus is actually no longer in charge or alive when the temple is finished. It's in fact his son Darius. And so we see that Darius, if the part that we skipped over in Ezra is Israel writes back to the king because they have their opposition writing letters against them. Then they write to Darius appealing to him to honor the decree that Cyrus had made to bring Israel back to the promised land and to restore their worship. And so Darius actually goes and he searches the archives. and he searches the royal archives and he finds the Cyrus decree, which was that Israel could rebuild in the promised land. And he acts on that decree. In fact, if you go a few verses earlier, this isn't up on the screen, but if you look at verses 8 through 10 in chapter 6, verses 8 through 10 in chapter 6, Darius responds saying, "Moreover, I make a decree regarding what you shall do for these elders of the Jews for the rebuilding of the house of God. The cost is to be paid to these men in full without delay from the royal revenue, the tributes of the province beyond the river." Now, beyond the river meant Israel, beyond the Euphrates River. So it meant Israel. That's what they were calling the land at that time, beyond the river. "And whatever is needed, bulls, rams, sheep, for burnt offerings to the God of heaven, wheat, salt, wine, oil, as the priests of Jerusalem require, let it be given to them day by day without fail." Now get this. Not only does Darius honor Cyrus's decree, but he says, you know, the taxes that Persia is making on the promised land, these taxes, in fact, are going to pay for the completion of the temple. And you know what? I'm going to supply all the needs. It's like, to relate it to us, it's like Darius is like, "I'm going to pay for the electric bill and also the communion elements. And next week when we have the crawfish boil, I'm going to pay for all that too." And Darius isn't doing that, but that's just kind of an example that, like, he's saying, "I'm going to provide for Israel to be able to worship Yahweh." And so God is completely at work through a pagan ruler and his people to see his house of worship, the temple, rebuilt. So here's the thing. Let us never get discouraged that God is not at work, even a year like 2020, right? And a year like 2021. And y'all know 2020 wasn't bad just for our in 2021, our racial unrest and our global pandemic that we had. The economy struggled. And y'all know we had a pretty heated political season, right? And so it was a tough season all around, but God is still at work in the midst of all that. And that's why the Old Testament encourages us that God brings his plans to completion. And what we see in verse 13 is, "Then, according to the word sent by Darius the king, the governor of the land beyond the river, Tattenai, and Shetharbozenai, I don't know how Laura said it, but whatever she said, and their associates did with all" what? "Diligence." Now the word here for diligence means to have strict care. It means that they got to work, and their work was pushed forward by the decree of a pagan king. And furthermore, we see that God, through in verse 14, through the prophesying of Haggai and Zechariah, encouraged the people. So God is not only at work through the prophets here in the Old Testament, he's also at work through the decrees of the pagan king. So we see that God's hand is on all of this. And let us not be discouraged that God's hand is not upon the land in which we live today. Now, America is we like to call it God's country. Know this, God cares for the entire world. America is not unique to any other country, but God wants all nations, all tribes, all tongues to worship him. But when we get discouraged, know that God is in control. If in fact this past week, did anybody get stuck in the traffic with Joe Biden? Anybody when he was in town? And so it was pretty cool. I was coming from the North Shore, and I was actually about to go over to Brother Tim's house, and we were going to talk about the crawfish boil next week. And I'm coming from a meeting on the North Shore, and I'm talking to Laura because she's about to start pickups for the kids, and I see this gigantic plane in the sky, and I'm like, that's different, you know, it's taking a different path. I'm like, I bet you it's Air Force One. And so I called Laura. She was like, I don't know about that. And then it passed her, and she was like, yeah, that's Air Force One. And so, like, Air Force One lands. But then hours later, after meeting with the Wellers at Brother Pete and Becky's house, talking about the crawfish boil, hours later, it took me like over an hour to get back from Kenner to my house. And I was a little frustrated because I avoided the interstate. I got on West Esplanade. But through all that, God pushed, stirred in me to pray for our president, just as the Bible, rather than being frustrated at the traffic that Joe Biden's entourage had called. That was a good time. I was being still, because I was physically being still, to pray for the president. And I posted something about that on social media. And I will tell you, I was a little discouraged by some of the vile remarks that I got to that, because I don't care if you didn't vote for the man. The Bible says, and if you despise the man, the Bible says we pray for our leaders. In fact, the book of Daniel says that that God raises leaders and he gets rid of leaders. And the book of Romans tells us that there is no leader that we're supposed to submit to governing authorities, and there's no leader that's in power that's not by God's providence and design. And so what I want to encourage you is that Darius and Cyrus and Artaxerxes and Xerxes and all these Persian leaders were, if we think Trump or Biden or Obama or Bush, or if we don't like any of them, know that these dudes were probably worse. They were worse, but God was still in control. And God still worked through even men whose hearts weren't turned towards him for the goodness of his kingdom and for his glory. We see all throughout Scripture that God is in control. These should be on the screen. Job 42, verse 2. Job cries out, he says, I know, talking to Yahweh, I know you can do all things and that no plan or purpose of yours can be thwarted. Nothing that God plans can be stopped. He is in complete control. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 37. Who has spoken and has come to pass unless the Lord has commanded it? God is in control of everything. Romans 8, 28. We know that God works all things together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Furthermore, Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, Paul writes, I am sure of this, encouraging the church, I am sure of this, that he who began, talk about Christ, he who began a work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. We know that God finishes his work just as he cried out on the cross, once he received the sour wine, it is finished. And we look forward to the book of Revelation where he says, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. We know that God completes his work. He never leaves it half finished. And because of this completed work, we can celebrate. Everything that God has, or God orchestrated. I'm not saying God caused global pandemics and disease and all this to happen, but God will orchestrate those evil things for the good of his people and the glory of who he is. God is at work and he completes his work, and God's people celebrate his work. And what we see is the temple is finished. And what we see here is that Israel responds with joy. They respond with worship. They celebrate the Passover. They furthermore celebrate the Feast of Unleavened Bread. If you don't know anything about those two festivals, they're pretty much interconnected. Passover celebrates the spirit passing over the firstborn in the book of Israel. And it also celebrates that God's hand of protection is on his people. And the Feast of Unleavened Bread took place the 7 days after Passover. Really, the difference between the two is that you ate bread in the Passover and you abstained from unleavened bread the week after. And that celebrates that God is hastily brought his people out of the promised land and that he is in charge. And so what we see here is that God makes us joyful. God makes us joyful. We celebrate his work because he's in charge. He's the one that puts joy in us. God makes us joyful. Look at verse 16 of chapter 6. It says this, and the people of Israel, the priests and the Levites and the rest of the returned exiles celebrated the dedication of the house of God. How did they celebrate it? How did they celebrate? Hey, Braden, I want you to get up and sit next to your mom. Get up now. Sometimes you got to correct your kids in the middle of your sermon. That's good. Mother's Day. Honor her. So here we go. So God's people celebrated him with joy. And this word for joy It means a overflowing chavad, and it means it can either be a feeling or an action. Joy is something sometimes that's hard to describe. Joy is not conditional on your emotion. Joy can't be commanded. You know that? Like, I can't tell you, be joyful. Joy is something that is so ingrained inside of you. It's there regardless of how you feel. Joy is ultimately a gift and a fruit, not a gift, but a sign that the Holy Spirit is in you. Y'all know the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. Joy is something that's put there by you, by God's presence abiding in you. John Piper defines joy this way. He says, Christian joy is a good feeling in the soul produced by the Holy Spirit as he causes us to see the beauty of Christ in the Word and in the world. Let me say that again. Christian joy is a good feeling in the soul, not on the surface, in the soul, produced by the Holy Spirit as he causes us to see the beauty of Christ in the Word and in the world. Joy is when you suffer a year like 2020 and you still believe in the goodness of God and his provision and that he's going to bring us all through. Joy cannot be, it's not something you can turn on and turn off. And I ask you today, if you don't have that joy, if you've lost that joy in the Creator God, if you've lost that joy in the Savior who hung on the cross for you and me, well, the Spirit is the one who gives us that joy. And the Bible says, if we who are evil know how to give good gifts to our children. Y'all, every year, I don't want to give my kids gifts on Christmas because they've been bad. I'm going to just be honest with you. But we want to give good gifts to our children, right? So if we know how to give gifts to our children, how much more, the Scripture says, will the Father give the Holy Spirit or goodness to those who ask him? So here's the application. Today, if you're not experiencing that joy, cry out to God. Cry out to God. He's the one that can give it to you. And he's the one that will bring you through it. He is the sustainer. He is the one worthy of all worship. And we see that that Israel dedicates here the temple. This word for dedication is where we get the word Hanukkah from. The same word, Chanukah, in the Hebrew is the word for Hanukkah. Now, the holiday Hanukkah is not, this isn't the exact same thing. The holiday Hanukkah actually commemorates when the Seleucid king actually defiled the temple and the Maccabean revolts happened and they reinstituted worship in the temple. And so that's what Hanukkah nowadays celebrates. But even when we see that coming up during the Christmas season, let us be reminded as Hanukkah is being celebrated that God is ultimately in control of his worship. And there might come a day when the temple seems defiled. We know now that the temple is not a building, but the temple's us. And so there's days where we feel defiled and we feel at our lowest. But God is in control and he's persevering his people to the end. God makes us joyful, so God's people celebrate that work. We worship him. Now, what is worship? What is worship? Verse 21. Let's read verse 21 again. Skipping down. It says, they slaughtered the Passover lamb. And just so you know how Passover worked, you took an unblemished lamb, and at midnight you slaughtered that lamb. And then with the bitter herbs and the unleavened bread, you celebrated and you feasted the next day. If we get anything from the Old Testament, it's this: that God's people are unfaithful, but he's faithful. And also that God's people know how to celebrate. Do y'all know God's people party a whole lot? They party a whole lot. Worship in the ancient Near East and in this time of Israel, worship wasn't just something that we do while we're singing on Sundays. Worship was something that was celebrated nationally. Worship was celebrated in the home. Worship was a lifestyle, and it was rowdy. It was good. It was amazing. And y'all know in the New Testament, it says that the early church, what did they do? Day by day, they attended the temple together, going house to house, breaking bread. Worship was not something done one day a week. Worship was something that was done by God's people every time that they woke up and they had breath in his lungs, because they had a God who had delivered them. And let us never forget. See, these people, they knew what it meant to be in exile. They knew what it meant to be in slavery and in captivity. Let us never forget what the enslavement of our sin before we experienced the grace of God was about. That led to death. But now, through the Spirit, we have life and we worship. It says that they separated themselves from the unclean practices of the land. Let's look at verse 21. It says, chapter 6, verse 21, it says this, and the Passover meal, it was eaten by the people of Israel who had returned from exile. And so it wasn't just the people who returned from exile. In fact, maybe even some of the people who were rejected last week when we looked at that weren't part of the decree to rebuild the temple. Maybe, in fact, some of them repented and turned back to Yahweh. Maybe, in fact, some Gentiles have already participated in this Passover meal. It says, and also by everyone who had joined them and separated themselves from the uncleanliness of the peoples of the land to what? It says, to worship the Lord. And this word for worship means to seek and to call. Worship is a crying out to God and acknowledging of who he is. We see that, I love what Louis Giglio, how he defines worship. He says in his book, The Air I Breathe, he says this, you, my friend, are a worshiper. Every day, all day long, in every place you worship, it's what you do, it's who you are. Think of it this way, worship is simply about value. The simplest definition I can give is this, worship is our response to what we value most. Worship is our response to what we value most. What do you value most? Do you value God in your life? Do you value the Holy Spirit working in you? Do you value God's word? Do you value spending time with him in prayer? Do you value sharing about him? Worship is simply a response to what we value most. That's why we don't have to beg you to give tithes and offerings to the king. Because worship is what you value most. You worship through the giving of your time and your talent and your treasure. Saved people who've tasted of the grace and the goodness of God want to pour out praise back to him. Worship is simply acknowledging what you value the most. And what we value here is the joy that God has placed in his people. Psalm chapter 92, verse 4 says, for you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work, and at the works of your hands I sing for joy. So we sing and we cry out, we do the things that we do because of the joy that God gives us. And what our first song that we sang today, song by the Ring Collective. I highly encourage you, if you need to put that on your playlist, the joy of the Lord is my strength. If you've never worshiped with an Irish band, you know, like you've never worshiped. Like, so I encourage you to find that on one of your playlists, the Ring Collective. It's loud, it's rowdy, but it's good. It probably echoes the way Israel worshiped. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And that echoes the book of Nehemiah. You see, Ezra and Nehemiah are actually connected. And so we see Israel faced opposition, but this isn't the last opposition that Israel had to overcome. In the book of Nehemiah, they face even more opposition. And Nehemiah reminds the people in Nehemiah, chapter 8, verse 10, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Do you need to hear that today? Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The Mother's Day reminds us, some of us, our mothers have gone. Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Death is not the end for those who follow Jesus. Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Maybe you have a strained relationship with your mother. Maybe you have a strained relationship with your daughter. Maybe you have a strained relationship with another female in your life, your spouse, somebody else. Do not be grieved. The joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy allows us to acknowledge who God is, and the joy helps us to do something about the grief and the hurt in our lives, to take care of it, to diligently work towards it, and to find a solution that can't be found in what we do, but only in what God has done. We see that as we cry out and we worship God, He builds us up. Y'all know that worship? I've heard it said this way. Worship is warfare. Worship is warfare. When you're in the car, I encourage you, put on some good music. I'm not saying you can't listen to, I mean, hey, Laura and I are old school. We like good Journey album every now and then, you know? There's nothing wrong with listening to regular music. But every now and then on your drive, worship. Whether it's turning on Life Songs or K-Love or maybe popping in a CD. I don't know if they make those anymore, but or just something digital that you can cast onto your. Worship is warfare. Know this, it's hard to cuss somebody out when they've cut you off in traffic when you're worshiping. Worship is warfare because it not only, as you acknowledge who God is, it also builds you up. And what we see here in the last verse, let's look at verse 22. It says, they kept the feast of unleavened bread with 7 days with joy. Notice how many times joy is mentioned in this passage. That's why we made a point that God is the one who makes us joyful. And he made them joyful, and he turned the heart of the king of Assyria to them. In fact, it's looking back and saying that even the evil Assyrians, who were the first people to conquer Israel, the northern kingdom, and then after them, the Babylonians came. And then Persia rose up. No matter what evil force came against God's people, God used those evil forces to ultimately work out his glory and the good of his people. And it says this, he made them joyful, and he turned the hearts of all, I'm going to paraphrase here, of the kings. And he says that he aided them in the work of the house of God, the God of Israel. The word here for aided means to strengthen and to grow firm. To strengthen and to grow firm. The king of Assyria may not honor, we may not like the king of Assyria. We may not like the Persian Empire. We may not like Babylon. We may not like living in the city of New Orleans. We may not like Kenner. We may not like anything around us, but know this, that God is working through our midst for his glory and our good. And as we acknowledge who he is, he builds us up so that we can do what he has called us to do. So as a church, the title of this sermon series is Forward. And we as a church are embarking on a campaign to look forward, just as Israel looked forward from captivity to re-inhabiting the promised land. We, as Family Church, look forward to a season of harvest. Luke chapter 10, verse 2 says, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send laborers out into his harvest. Our church family met for a family meeting not that long ago, a couple of weeks ago, and we laid out the fact that we are going to do some things this summer to reach out to our neighborhood. Furthermore, we're going to do some work on our building. We're going to talk about that more in June. We're going to challenge our church family to give a little bit above and beyond what we've already done to pay for some of the works and the improvements that we need to do. But praise God that God isn't just going to accomplish it through us. In fact, we've already had several tens of thousands of dollars committed to the work that we're doing here, because God works even in a year like 2020 and 2021, where less people are going to church, less people are able to give faithfully, but God still works so that he can accomplish his purpose. We move forward with worship and with boldness. And I want to invite you next week. We have our crawfish boil. Here's where I want to invite you to do. We're encouraging you, if you can, $10 a person, $20 a a family. If you can do that, give. Like I was talking to Mr. Robert, he was asking me about it. If you want to give online and just tell one of us that you've given online towards that, or if you just want to lay something in the offering plate next week, we're not going to come around and be like, you gave us your $10, you gave us your $10. You can't have a seat at the table unless you gave us your... We're not going to do that. We just want to kind of help pay for some of the supplies that we're going to get. But we're doing this crawfish boil, so one, that we can encourage and grow one another as the church did day by day. But also, this is an opportunity. We didn't put a big sign up outside that says crawfish boil next weekend. And part of the reason we didn't do that is because when you do that type of thing, you get a lot of people. And here's what we want to do. This is what we want to challenge you. We want to challenge you to invite the people. Not for us to have some heavy marketing campaign. Maybe we'll do that next year. But for you to invite the people. So know this. There's a seat at the table for whoever you invite next week. If we don't have enough crawfish, we're going to do about 60 pounds of crawfish. If we don't have enough, you know, we'll send somebody across the street to Kenner Seafood and get some more, you know. We'll go pick up another sack and make Tim work even longer. You know what I mean? You know? So invite people. This is your opportunity. Don't pass this by. This is an opportunity for you to invite someone to be a part of the family of God, because they will hear about his goodness. Even if they don't show up till after the service is over, they will experience God's glory and worship through the church as we break crawfish together, right? It's like breaking bread, you know? Like, as we break bread together and we enjoy and honor who Jesus is through what we eat and how we fellowship. And know this, if you don't like crawfish, we're going to have some hot dogs and some other things for that, but I encourage you, my mother has already told me we have to pick her up again next week, and she doesn't eat crawfish, but she picks everything else. She likes everything else in the boil, but the crawfish, my kids just play with them, you know? So, like, we're going to have enough crawfish. It's going to be an awesome time. I want to encourage you, next week is not just about you. Next week is about your neighbor. Next week is about those who where you live, where you work, where you eat and where you play, who don't know Jesus. Because God's people celebrate his work. And we want to invite as many people as we can to join the family. So let's pray. God, we thank you so much for who you are. God, we thank you for your work through your church, God. We thank you that just as you're working in 2021, God, you worked many thousands of years ago through your people, coming out of exile and back into the promised land. God, you completed the temple. Even when Israel got scared and stopped, God, you helped complete the temple. You rose up prophets to encourage your people. You rose up and used pagan kings, Lord, to provide the provision that your people needed to complete their work. So God, today, since we no longer have to use a building to get to know you. God, now that your spirit lives in us, now that we are the temple of God, help us to honor you in the lives that we live. Help us to trust you and help us to fight for joy. God, you're great. You're great. You're awesome and you're worthy of all praise. So God, today, help us to cry out and respond, acknowledging who you are. God, help us to know as we sing with joy, you build us up and we war against everything that wants to tear us down. So let's respond as your people. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Would you stand? Know this, if you haven't followed Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the Bible says, anyone who calls upon that name, his name, shall be saved. Christian, if you're down and depressed and out right now, know this. Anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. While your salvation is secure, we trust that the Spirit is the one who builds us up, and the Spirit is the one who helps us persevere to the end. So let's trust in the Holy Spirit today. Let's respond with a hymn of praise.
Oh Lord, my God.
I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great.